Welcome to George Mason University's Studio A. My name is Rick Davis, and today our guest is Tim Gordon. Tim is the Executive Director of the Foundation for the Advancement of African Americans in Film and the President of the Washington, D.C. Area Film Critics Association. Tim, welcome to Studio A.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here. Great. Glad to be here.
You're a man who's seen a lot of movies.
Yes, I have, and that is not necessarily a good thing.
What got you into this business?
As a child, I had a father who was like a film aficionado to the nth degree. And from the age of five, you know, he started taking me to the movies. And at the time, I didn't really understand what I was watching, but it also instilled a love of film, which I actually carried over to life today as we know it.
Was there some single film or some event that sort of said, I made you get up one day and say, I'm going to be a film critic?
You know, interestingly enough, the one event that I could probably trace back is I know my father worked at the Newark Star-Ledger, which would be the equivalent here in D.C. of like the Washington Post. And I remember one night I went to visit him after work, and he took me upstairs to like where they had the room, where they had like the old archives.
Oh.
Not archives as we have them now online, but literally old newspapers rolled out. And I remember he gave me a book that was an MGM I guess their pre-production schedule had had movies like 4 to 5 years in advance of movies that they were planning in production, which I thought was the coolest thing as a kid. I was like, wow. So it helped frame in my mind that I wanted to be in the business, but I know I never had a desire to ever act or direct a movie. I wouldn't mind producing one, but it helped instill in me at that age that this was the business that I wanted to be in.
How did you go about then sort of preparing for that? How do you study to be a film critic?
Well, interestingly enough, there was a period of about maybe 4 or 5 years where I literally saw every movie that was released. And, you know, it helped that they had theaters at the time that would have like Dollar Thursdays, and I would go in and pay a dollar and watch five movies and then come out. And I got a reputation as a guy who saw movies all the time, so everybody would always come up and ask me, you know, what did you think about this movie, or what can you recommend for me? So that was my introduction on how I got into the business.
So total immersion in the
total
media.
Immersion.
Yeah. And then what was your first? When did you write your first professional review?
Goodness gracious, 1990 or 91.
Wow, I so 20 plus years.
Yeah, I literally, you know, again, my life is more complex than we can go into in a half an hour, but I've always been the type of person that, instead of following the rules, I've always tried to just do my own thing. So instead of finding a publication that would support my work and would print my stuff, the way I got my start is I created a newsletter 20 years ago and found some friends who loved movies as much as I did, and we all put together the Renaissance Review, and that was my first vehicle of getting reviews out.
Was that in D.C.?
It was actually based here, but we actually at our highest point, probably had about 27 states that we were distributing newsletters to.
So today, that's kind of like somebody starting a website and sort of getting their reviews out there.
Well, somebody starting a website, but starting a website where it's not going global and they're just moving around from state to state. Yeah. So same sort of a mentality.
Well, that's fantastic. And then your career's progressed in a rather exceptional way because you're now the head of the Critics Association here, and you're on television, and you're
that's a funny story of how I became the president of the Film Critics Association. I've started reviewing here in D.C. as I said, probably about '92, and we didn't have a Film Critics Association. So every year when we would get to award season, we would watch with envy as New York and Boston and L.A. So the critics would get together and create a group. And I was, I guess, with the personality I have, I was always a guy that talked to all the critics and knew the critics. And one day I was at a screening, and Nell Minow, another good friend of mine who's a critic in D.C., walked up to me and said, you know, we're putting together a group, and we all think you should be the president. And I went, what qualification? So it's worked out well for 10-plus years. We just had our 10th award back in December. Everything's gone off without a hitch. It's well-respected, big market, so I'm happy.
That's great. And we're in Oscar season now, and so you must be all excited about that.
I'm not.
You're not.
I thought this year that the Oscar nominations were just, for lack of a better word, just odd. I mean, you got You can go to 10 movies that you nominate for Best Picture, but you nominate 9. Mm-hmm. You can nominate 3 songs, and you had 37 candidates, and you nominate 2. I was really confused. And then there were movies that I loved that got no nominations, like Shame. I think Melancholia got 1. So I wasn't really sure what the Academy was going for, other than celebrating film with films like Hugo and the Artist, which have 21 nominations combined. But strange year, but it also talks about the deterioration of the motion picture business when you look at some of the films that are nominated for some of these major awards.
Well, there's a few films that I know from our extensive advanced research on you that you actually admire a great deal. Godfather Part II is one. Raising the Sun is another. Yes. And Coming to America is another. What ties those films together for you, or what elevates them to a stature that you keep coming back to?
Well, Godfather Part II, to me, it's kind of like my personal favorite. I was telling the story to the producer when he called me that I had the honor 9 years ago when the Oscars was celebrating the 75th anniversary. Susan Wachowski, who's an editor and a film critic for USA Today, got myself, Richard Roper, Roger Ebert, Peter Travers from Rolling Stone, and a group of us together to go over the best of the best films. So they took every decade, I guess from 1927 to, at that point, 2004. Wow. They went through the decades. They found all the best picture winners.
Wings.
And then, well, no, I was ready to get to that. So they did it by decade. Yeah. So, you had the best film of the 20s, the best picture of the 30s, 40s, et cetera. So three of us wrote, small essays in USA Today about The Godfather. And I remember mine was, from the opening moment you hear Nino Rota's score and you see that sunken-in chair, this is America. It feels to me almost as if almost every scene in that movie, there are no wasted moments, no wasted scenes. I think it's almost as close to, in my mind, a perfect movie of what it should be. Absolute storytelling at the nth degree, the best level.
Amazing.
And also the film that once he passes, people will talk about, Francis Ford Coppola, absolutely. The Godfather.
So Raisin, what about that one?
Raisin and the Sun, Lorraine Hansberry's film, her play from 1959. Mm-hmm. I think what's so strong about that again, and probably the theme is storytelling, is that I think that story works with any ethnic group. You can take African Americans out and put Jewish Americans in and the story would work. Yeah. You can take Italian Americans. You can put anybody in that story because it's universal as a family drama. I just think it's a great film.
Beautiful writing.
Absolutely.
Well.
And an amazing performance from Sidney Poitier.
Yeah. And then Coming to America?
Coming to America is just fun.
Just fun.
I mean, this movie I've probably seen, I would guesstimate, over 100 times easily. And it still makes me laugh as hard if I were to watch it right now as when I first saw it back in 1989.
Wow.
Of all the stuff that Murphy's done, and for a lot of the younger students here who only know Murphy now, don't realize that 30 years ago, this guy was like the largest thing in Hollywood.
Yeah.
And for all of those comedies he's made, I think this is the one that really aged the best and lasts the best for Eddie.
Now we're going to talk for a second here about a real contemporary issue, and that is the Girl with the Dragon Tattoo, which, of course, has a Swedish original and an American version. And you liked one a lot and didn't like the other so much. Tell us about that, and then we're going to show a clip and have you talk about it.
I think the biggest issue that I had with the Girl with the Dragon Tattoo, and I think they should legislate some sort of law in Hollywood, that if you're going to remake a movie, you got to put at least 5 years between the original and the remake.
It was quick, wasn't it?
I don't understand, and again, I do a talk show as well every week, and I was having huge arguments on air that, A, the only reason why they remade this movie is because it was a popular book that everybody sort of read. Mm-hmm. But the central primary reason was that the Swedish version was subtitled. And Americans don't read subtitles, which I think is just ludicrous because you miss out on amazing films because you don't want to read a movie. I mean, I sit and do it. I mean, we've got critics around the country that do it. But I just thought it was an unnecessary film that didn't need to be made, and I'm really incensed that they would nominate Rooney Mara for a Best Actress Oscar, but Noomi Rapace, who creates the role, got ignored, and they did 3 films, and she never got nominated for anything.
Yeah. Well, we have a clip, a really interesting clip. It's kind of a quiet clip, but set this up for us, and then we'll talk about it during it if you want.
Well, the clip is the introduction of her character. I mean, you kind of see her on the periphery, but and the director's name, who we were in the green room trying to figure out how to pronounce, I just gave up. The director of the film, shoots the scene in a way that I think is really creatively done. And her body, her length, does a lot of the acting for her. But what I like so much about the camera work and the cinematography the DP does in the scene is that he shoots a lot of the stuff kind of far off, yeah. which gives her character, to me, more of a mystique, more of a menace than if you kind of got the camera in tight.
Okay, let's watch.
Yeah. There's a lot of stuff going on in this clip. And, you know, you're looking at here, I guess, the angst of Michael Bloomquist as they're, you know, getting to the point where they're setting up, this woman who's been investigating him, who at some point in the film for people, and I guess I hope I'm not spoiling this for people who haven't seen the film.
That's all right.
Well, at some point, the two of them will work together. And this is her investigating him now, so...
And that's the first thing we see of her?
Well, yeah, but you'll have a scene coming up momentarily where she comes in a room and she's introduced and you'll talk to her. So you see her at work before you find out who she really is. Oh, subtitles. See how
there
pleasant
is.
That is?
Speciell flicka.
Alltså hur då speciell?
Ja, men missbedöm henne inte. Hon är vår absolut bästa resurser.
Uh-huh.
God morgon, Lisbeth.
See what I'm saying about the angles?
Mm-hmm.
God morgon.
I love him. He's loving this. I think in the American David Fincher version, you know, they tried to concentrate too much on the physical appearance that Rooney Mara has to undertake, and not so much in what I thought was the character development. Mm. And when I say character development, I know people are going to say, well, it's the same movie. Yeah, but Fincher's perspective on it is I'm not sure exactly what a good word for it would be. I think the Swedish version had a certain tone about it that I don't think that the American version captures well.
And is it more in the cinematography or...?
Well, I think it's more in, believe it or not, you know, when you look at foreign films are handled differently than than American films. We can't take the same content and kind of shoot it the same way. Our audience isn't designed that way. Now, the only other thing I would say about Noomi Rapace and one last kind of critique between her and Rooney Mara is Rooney Mara, a critic reminded me, sort of looks more like, you know, the title, The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo, where Rooney Mara doesn't sort of look like she ever needs any saving or assistance.
Hmm.
She looks like, from the moment you see her, she's introduced, she looks like she can handle herself quite well, which is what a feeling I never got from watching Rooney in the American version.
Ja, finns det någonting mer?
Jag har anlitat för att undersöka Blomqvist, inte gräva hans jobb.
Men jag skulle nog ändå gärna vilja höra din personliga åsikt.
Blomqvist är vit. Han har inte ens en fortkörningsbot. Jag hittar ingenting på honom. Jag tror inte att han har fabricerat falska bevis mot Wennerström. Jag tror någon har blåst honom.
That was enlightening. Thank you for that. And they're going to dub us into Swedish in post-production. So
oh, that would be nice.
we're going to turn to our students now and our studio audience, and I'm sure they have some questions for you. Go ahead.
When rating films, what are your main criteria?
I'm looking for several things. I'm looking for storytelling because we all know that there are probably about 12 basic plots that are used over and over with different ethnicities and locales and et cetera. So I'm looking for that. I'm looking for, as we just talked about in this clip, I'm looking for cinematography. I'm looking for shot selection. I think music is an important element. A score can get you heightened in a scene. It can actually relieve some tension in the scene. It actually can help a slow scene along. So I'm looking for those facets, but more important than anything else is about the storytelling.
Great. Another question, please. Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Brendan.
How are you, Brendan?
I'm doing well, thanks. I'm just curious, what kind of advice can you give someone who's just starting out in the film business or who wants to get started in the film business?
Are you talking about as it relates to being a filmmaker?
Yeah, just in the industry in general.
Well, first, I would say, and you heard me tell my story earlier, that I kind of went against type. You've got to understand who you are and what interests you. It would also probably help if there's certain filmmakers or certain styles of films that you like to kind of study who some of those masters are. I talked to a gentleman on the way in who told me he loved, I'm trying to remember the directors. I think it was, I can't remember the two directors he told me, but I told him that that's a good place to start by studying those works and also perfecting your craft and working on it. Are you just planning on being the type of filmmaker that's a director and not a writer, or do you want to kind of combine both?
I mean, I'm open for pretty much all options. I'm really kind of just taking it as it comes, playing it by ear.
Because
I do
well?
Like to write.
Do you
I
write
do
well?
Write well, yeah. I mean,
okay. Well, no, I mean, that's not, yeah. I'm not being critical, but I'm saying if you write well, then maybe part of what you wanted to start to develop is to work on some screenplays and have that idea in your head on how you want, visually, how you want to tell that story to an audience.
Right.
Yeah.
Great. Another question. Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm Tyler. I was just wondering what your personal pick is for Best Picture this year.
I'm going to tell you something really strange, and if it happens, I'm not Nostradamus anything. I have a feeling this year that that the obvious choices are, as I told you earlier, would be Hugo and The Artist. I think, and for reasons that I will talk about in more detail on my show next week, I got a feeling that The Help just feels like it's going to sneak in there, because I'm looking at how the tea leaves have been going throughout the Oscar season. I'm looking at the Golden Globes. I'm looking at SAG, the DGAs, and all these awards. There seems to be a lot of momentum for that film. Now, personally, I would not vote for it, but I think that the industry, and it's kind of strange in that way, if you guys study the history of the Oscars, that it's never about merit. It's always about, you know, people kind of, if you got a good marketing campaign, you can win an Oscar. So it's not necessarily the best film. It's the best marketed film. But my personal opinion, I think I would have voted for The Descendants this year.
Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm Zalika, and I was just wondering, what's your favorite movie of all time and why?
Well, we talked about the Godfather film a lot, but there's so many movies that I really like. And for me, film is more about a director's medium than anything else. So if I like a director, I kind of have an affinity for his film. So I love Akira Kurosawa. I love Scorsese. I love Christopher Nolan, even though we had some people in the room who were hating on his work. I like early Spielberg. I just don't like a lot of the kind of contemporary stuff he's done. But I would probably, I still hold on to The Godfather, and I probably like Godfather 2 better than I like Godfather 1 for the sheer scope of the story, you know, and also the first time you ever see both Pacino and De Niro, even though they're not on screen together until we see Heat years later, but it's just an amazing movie, wonderful saga of a family, Italian family.
Great. Anybody else have a question? Yes, we have time for I think one more, and I'm going to pick you.
Okay. What do you find is the hardest challenger as a writer in films?
The hardest challenge, I would think, is that in many of the movies that are out now, you heard me talk about it earlier when we were talking about The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo. I think there's a certain sensibility that we're a puritanical society in America. So when you watch foreign films, they feel a lot freer. The writing is a lot more fluid. But you're constrained here with how you have to write. I think that and the lack of creativity that I see in so many films now is probably the biggest stumbling block for a writer right now.
Great. Terrific. Well, thank you all in the studio audience. Great questions. I have a couple more. We were talking earlier, actually, before we were on the air, about the difference between seeing a film in the theater, which you do a lot. You go to a lot of screenings. But you also have to see dozens or maybe more movies a year just at home on your home TV. Do you ever compare the aesthetic experience of seeing a film on the big screen, and do you ever change your mind about a film?
Well, we talked about this, and people, and again, I almost hate to admit this because this is going to go on the record, and people will be able to come back and, like, blackmail me at some point.
I always ask the tough questions.
But there absolutely are movies that I have detested, not just didn't like, detested in theaters that are just fine to watch at home.
Yep.
And the best example, and you'll laugh at this, the best example is a Martin Lawrence film called What's the Worst Thing That Can Happen with him and Danny DeVito. I think it's the most enjoyable thing to watch at my house. In the theater? Hell no. think about this for a second. You in the world of cable television now, where there's so many different channels and so many movies, am I the only person who's ever laid in the bed late at night and you start flipping through channels and go, oh, okay, there's a bad movie. And you can watch a bad movie and enjoy it at home. But then there are films like Bridesmaids that, they sent me a screener. Didn't work at home, didn't work in the theater, just didn't like that movie. So it doesn't work for every movie, but there are some that it does work for.
Do you find yourself being swayed or influenced by, you see movies earlier than most people, but there probably is some buzz, around about movies when you see them. Do you find yourself being influenced at all in advance or even afterwards by other critics' opinions or audience reaction or...
Well, as a rule, I get alerts on my phone from both the Hollywood Reporter and Variety, and they always will send early advance, reviews, and probably about a week before we see each film. Mm-hmm. And unless it's a film that I already like, I give you a good example. Like we talk about The Dark Knight. The Dark Knight was a film I just want to read like the first paragraph of it just to find out the tone before I would see it. Yeah. But as a rule, I probably would stay away from reading other people's reviews. Now the hard part is when we're at a screening and it's just you and 50 other critics.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody starts talking, and it's hard to try to keep somebody else's voice out of your head, so that doesn't work well a lot. But as it relates to reading advanced reviews, I can stay away from that. But
do you ever see a film with the rest of us civilians and then review it, or is it always in a
Well, the only time I see a movie with the general audience is when the movie is so bad that the studio will not screen it for critics, like Ghost Rider.
Wow.
Spirit of Vengeance.
Now, how often does that happen?
Well, ironically, it has happened probably about, I want to say, 4 or 5 times, and we're just in February, which is not a good sign.
Wow.
So, they didn't screen that wonderful Katherine Heigl, Something for the Money.
Right.
I don't know if it's one or two for the money.
Right.
Tyler Perry's films never screen. So, Good Deeds won't screen in a week.
Right.
So.
But he's kind of review proof, right?
Well, he should be something proof, but he's not review proof. He's a wonderful filmmaker as it relates to understanding Hollywood's blueprint and never having to have hat in hand trying to have a film made. He understands that he can make them for between $5 to $10 million. He has a marketing deal with Lionsgate. Lionsgate will distribute what he makes. So he can get every movie made. Now, quality is another story.
Right.
But getting a film made, he has mastered that.
Have you ever liked a movie that wasn't released for reviews in advance? I mean, is it always a dead signal that it's not going to work?
I'm going to tell you, when I first got into the business 20 years ago, the only two times it would happen is if it was a movie that was a good example of a movie they would never have screened 20 years ago would have been The Dark Knight.
Uh-huh.
They didn't have to. I mean, it was a movie that the audience was going to go and see anyway, but they've gotten away from that. Now it's about, it's clearly cold openings, the phrase we use. Cold openings only are for movies that are just wretched. And the studio goes, we're not even going to set up a screening for this because, all they're going to do is just trash it and tear it up anyway.
Yep.
And then you do.
And that we do. That we do.
Another aspect of your work that I talked about in the intro, but we haven't talked about since, is your role as the director, or the chairman, rather, of the Foundation for the Advancement of African Americans in Film. Tell us a little bit about that organization and your work there.
FAF is something that I created probably in 2004, and it was largely created because I have this kooky idea that if you teach students, and I'm not just saying African-American students, if you teach students that there's more to filmmaking than just being a director or being an actor, mm-hmm. and that it's a multi-billion dollar business that has attorneys, that has, folks who operate cameras, that operate, electronics, computers. That was the impetus behind that. And essentially what we've done with it is that I have two core programs. One is called Real Kids, which we work with middle school to high school students, kind of introducing them to film, education, the opportunities in film. And then for undergrad students, we have something called the Producers Institute, where you teach students how to take an idea in their head and turn it into a motion picture. You know, all the steps that are in between.
Fantastic. Yeah. So you do the mentoring and
absolutely.
Yeah, that's fantastic. The role of African-American work in film, both as subject and as artists, how do you see that evolving? Pick a time frame, because one could be arbitrary, you know, X number of decades, but where do you see that going?
Well, the challenge for me is when I first got into the business, that was my forte. I mean, I focused on it like a, you know, with laser-like intensity, and I broke it down into what I call three periods. And, you know, my first business, my first company was called Third Renaissance, which stood for the Third Renaissance of African-American Film, and I broke it into periods from 1910 with William Foster's first short film all the way up to 1949, which is kind of what I call the race period with Oscar Michaud, Spencer Williams. 1950, where Sidney Poitier emerges, you have the first African-American leading man up until 1985. So you have a period that's heavily dominated by Poitier. And then from 1986, with the emergence of Spike Lee, to now, that third Renaissance period. I think the challenge, as I talk to filmmakers all the time, and I was at I did a screening of a movie with a director over the weekend, and I was talking to him that the biggest challenge is distribution moving forward in the 21st century, because to make a movie, to make a CD, to write a book, to do anything in the arts, if you can't get it distributed, it doesn't really mean anything. So, you know, 15 years ago, the buzzword in Hollywood was production company. Everybody wanted to have a production company. Well, a production company only works if you have a distribution source for it. And I think African-American filmmakers are really suffering now because there's some really good work that's out there that, you know, I was going to say for whatever reason, the reason is always money, that they can't figure out how to get these films to a wider or a general audience.
Time for the Fourth Renaissance.
It is. The Fourth Renaissance needs money. The Fourth Renaissance needs distribution. Yeah. That's that Renaissance. And that's not just African-American films. I would say for general mainstream films, you see with the economy being what it is right now, the studios, probably about 10 or 15 years ago, everybody had boutique houses. Warner had WIP, Warner Independent Films. You had the Weinsteins had their smaller group. So that has kind of gone away to dinosaur, which takes away opportunities for students like these who at some point have good story ideas and no distribution means to get those stories told.
Well, we have to wrap, but we could talk forever.
We
thank
actually
you so
could.
Much, Tim. This was great. Tim
Not
Gordon,
a problem.
Thanks
thank
for
you.
Being our guest today on
thank
Studio
you.
A. I'm Rick
Not
Davis.
A problem.
Thanks for watching.
And thank you guys.